Hi, everyone. You've tuned in to our 2021 Berkeley Lab SLAM competition. I can see you're all waiting in your living rooms. You're all looking great, except for maybe Brandon, who decided to go for the sweater and pajama bottoms, but we'll work on that later. So in the next few minutes, you've got some time to maybe grab a beverage for the next 2 hours, grab some popcorn, get yourself really comfortable because we really have a treat ahead of you for the next 2 hours. So you're going to see some of Berkeley Lab's finest talents battle it out for the title of Berkeley Lab SLAM Champion 2021. So get yourself a nice comfortable seat, grab yourself a beverage, and I'll be back in a little while, but we've got some messages first, some interviews with the lab finalists by Brian Mello and a message from Director Witherell. So grab yourself a beverage and you'll see me again in a few minutes time. So looking forward to the next 2 hours. Enjoy, everyone.
First, let's say where you're from.
France.
Germany.
India.
China.
New York.
I'm from China.
Austria.
India.
Houston, Texas.
Slovakia.
Belgium.
South Korea.
Now, what kind of scientist are you?
Plant biologist.
I'm a chemical engineer.
A wireless engineer.
Astrophysicist.
I'm a synthetic biologist.
I'm a mathematician.
I'm an engineer doing water treatment technology.
I'm a chemist and a material scientist, so I would classify myself as an interdisciplinary scientist.
I'm a condensed matter physicist.
Microbiologist.
I'm a physicist studying material science.
Environmental biotechnologist.
How are you feeling about the upcoming research slam?
I'm super excited to be part of this.
Excited and terrified at the same time.
I'm super excited to bring my story and represent the Earth and environmental sciences area.
Nervous, but exciting.
Can't wait.
It's a great opportunity and I think I will definitely enjoy very much.
I'm excited.
I'm a little nervous, but I'm excited to use this as an opportunity to practice good science communication.
I'm excited to be participating in the SLAM.
Yeah, I'm a little bit nervous, but I'm also very excited to share my research.
It's gonna be a lot of fun.
I was not feeling very nervous about the SLAM in the beginning, but as the deadline is coming closer and closer, I'm starting to get a bit nervous.
What problem are you trying to solve? You're not trying to solve a problem. You don't.
No, as I told you, yeah, this is not a problem.
My research focuses on how material reacts to intense lasers.
I build environmental sensors for climate scientists.
I want to make fuels from sunlight.
I'm studying plant microbe interactions so that we can make these interactions more efficient and limit our use of chemical fertilizer on crops.
Revealing the hidden universe.
I work on developing computer software to, for example, solve climate change applications.
We need to store energy more efficiently.
Finding renewable energy resources to make our world a better place.
I'm working on filtration materials to enable green technology that will help us address climate change, which I think is the defining challenge of our generation.
Yeah! And that's it.
Hello, everybody. I'm Mike Witherell, the director of Berkeley Lab, and it's my pleasure and privilege to introduce our fourth annual SLAM event. I'm a bit nervous, but very excited. This year, we've been celebrating the lab's 90th anniversary, and it's been fun to look back on all of the lab's accomplishments so far. But more importantly, we're looking to the future. Think about how we can meet our grand national challenges with scientific solutions. Our postdocs and early career researchers will be the people to shape that future, and events like the SLAM give us a chance to meet these scientists and hear about their impressive projects. Today, we'll hear from 12 of these early career scientists and engineers. They've worked hard to get here. It's not that easy to boil down the complexities of their work to just 3 minutes in a way that non-scientists can understand. It takes a real master of science communication to do this well. And through these talks, our speakers not only share their passion for their work, but also its relevance to society. Mastering this type of communication will enable these speakers to connect with other scientists, both within and outside their field, as well as with the public. For our lab and other national labs, we need to be effective communicators to connect with our local communities, to demonstrate our value to state and federal lawmakers, and to describe our research accomplishments to our sponsors. So while this is a fun event, the skills it fosters are very serious and critical for us to continue to achieve our mission. So now it's my pleasure to introduce to you the inaugural Berkeley Lab Research SLAM champion, a theoretical materials scientist and staff scientist at the Molecular Foundry, and a communication grandmaster, SLAM co-host Sinead Griffin.
Great. Thank you very much, Dr. Witherell, for the brilliant introduction to everyone. So welcome again, everyone, to Berkeley Lab SLAM 2021. Some things you'll see will be very different this year. We've got 12 new champions. Some things will stay the same, though. And so I am delighted to once again welcome my MC squared, David Gilbert from the Joint Genome Institute. David, are you there? Please say you remember to sign in this time.
I am here, Sinead. Thank you very much. It again is an honor, truly, to share the virtual stage with you and these dozen remarkable early career leaders. I'm a science enthusiast, and so I'm right here at home at the SLAM, where publicly supported research is made understandable by all and to all, or at least that's the goal of this, and we'll let the judges and you, the audience, decide. The range of subjects today is truly astonishing, from algae to algorithms, water, plants, carbon, hydrogen, climate, cosmology, short-lived romance stories, sensors, shoes, balloons, rockets, fuels, nudibranchs.
What?
Telepathy, lasers and lightsabers. What more could a science nerd really want? Oh, I know, you'd like to hear it live from the source. And that's what we'll be doing this afternoon, putting these scientists and engineers on the spot, but in a very supportive environment, of course. I'm stoked. Sinead, you stoked?
I definitely am. And I see you got the memo about dressing sharper this year.
Yeah, I know. I shaved for you. So how are we going to do this? I think we've got some slides for the audience that can convey us through, hopefully. Right. So as Mike mentioned, we have 12 finalists. Each will try to convey their story in 3 minutes. And between each presentation, we'll join in a trivia contest with very lavish prizes if you respond in the polls. At the end, the audience and the judges will have an opportunity to vote for their favorite finalists. In the meantime, during that time of deliberation, stick around for DJ Miles for Green for his Groove Lounge and slideshow reminiscing about the previous SLAMs and postdoc week. And if you stick around, you'll get the news at 4:45 approximately. We'll announce all the new champions. And I think we've got a social media reminder where you can join the conversation right here. Remember, hashtag LabSlam 2021 and all those other great things. Let's see, what else are we forgetting here? I think it's your time, Sinead, to tell us about what happens next.
Right, so it is a competition after all. So we are the home of teen science, but we have to choose some winners. So it is okay to have some competition. And here is how we're going to be competing.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the main event.
So while the 12 contestants will all be competing for Lab Slam champion, there's also a bit of an internal Berkeley Lab competition between the different scientific areas that we have at the lab. They are computing sciences, earth and environmental sciences, physical sciences, energy technologies, biosciences, and energy sciences. So you'll see several representatives in the 12 finalists from all of these different areas. Who will be the champion area? We don't know yet. Energy sciences, my home division, already have two, so we're already leading the polls in that one. So keep out. The awards are, first place is $3,000, second is $2,000, and third prize is $1,000. So they'll be decided by our judging panel, who we'll meet shortly. But there's an important prize that you all have a role to play in, and that's the People's Choice Award of $750. So this is where you're going to have to actually do something. So once all of the finalists have presented, we're going to open a poll for you all. And this will be a chance for you all to vote for your favorites. So keep tuned in right till the end so you get a chance to vote for whoever you think did the best. And then when we announce the winners, we'll also announce the choice of the People's Choice Award. So David, I think you're going to tell us how they're going to be judged. Oh, no, I am. So we're going to have, again, the judging criteria, which is our esteemed panel of judges. And also you're going to have the chance to vote for your favorites. They are going to be judged on several things. So both on the significance and background of the research, having a clear, logical way of presenting the work, their enthusiasm, how they're actually communicating with the audience and getting their passion for their subject across. We want them to avoid scientific jargon. It's not much use explaining if it's full of words and phrases that we can't understand. We do want you to consider how they're able to capture and maintain your audience's attention throughout the 3 minutes of their presentation. We do also consider their stage presence and in this virtual format. That's a kind of a tricky job. And then finally, everyone does only have 3 minutes. So we have to make sure that everyone stays on time and they will be slightly penalized for going over or under that amount of time. So that's what the judges have today, a very, very hard job ahead of them.
Indeed, thanks Sinead. We're very grateful to our distinguished panel of judges for the 2021 Berkeley Lab SLAM. So please do turn on your camera as I introduce you and stay on screen. So firstly, we have Dr. Carol Burns, who was recently appointed Deputy Director for Research and Chief Research Officer here at Berkeley Lab. Next up is Aditi Chakravarti, who's the Interim Chief Diversity, Equity, and Inclusion, DEI Officer at Berkeley Lab. Hello, Aditi, good seeing you. Next up, we have the Honorable Terry Taplin, Berkeley City Council member who was raised in Southwest Berkeley, a Poetry Slam champion himself and community organizer. Thank you, Terry. Dr. Alan Wan is the Executive Director for National Laboratory Programs at the University of California National Laboratories Office. And a former colleague from Strategic Communications at Berkeley Lab, Sarah Yang is the Assistant Dean of Marketing and Communications at UC Berkeley's College of Engineering. Thank you so much, judges. Sinead, you've got a very important message for us, I think.
I do. So, okay. There's only so much Irish here, but there is Murphy's Law that if something is going to go wrong, it might. So we have some just in case messages. So if a finalist has some connection issue, tech issue, we have a plan in place. So what we'll do is we'll skip on to the next speaker and then we'll save the person who had the technical issue and tack them onto the end of the show. So if your favorite person has a connection issue, don't worry, we'll give them a chance. We'll give them a second chance at the end. At the end of today, all of the finalist talks will be published on slam.lbl.gov, so you can watch them there and they will stay there. So you can visit them next week or on Saturday night, you can revisit your favorite talks. Please cheer and applaud virtually for our 12 finalists, especially using our social media platforms. And finally, right at the end of all of the presentations, the chat will open and we'll all get a chance to participate and applaud all of our 12 panelists from today. Okay, David.
Is it time?
I think it might be.
All right, so let's
get
ready
to
slam.
Y'all ready for this?
So first up, the brave first person, our first slammer is Margot Bertrutzik. So Margot is actually a transplant from New York who pivoted from neurobiology. She didn't want to kill animals, but somehow is okay with killing plants. Her alter ego is a blue water sailor and she's ventured as far as Panama. She worked for a nonprofit farm in Kenya and this just inspired her to design better crops. So representing the biosciences area and the Joint Genome Institute, here's Margot with We'll Get By With a Little Help from Our Friends.
Oh my
Have you ever bought a plant and cared for it lovingly, only to have it die on you? Aside from being picky about how much water and light they get, plants need nutrients to survive. Now picture this on a nationwide scale for crops. Every year in the US, we pour about 20 million metric tons of fertilizer on soils to provide plants with nutrients. And some of these are not renewable, such as phosphate. So clearly something needs to be done. And one of the possible solutions lies with the tiniest organisms in the soil. You see, in the wild, plants obtain the nutrients they need with the help of microbes that interact with their roots, such as fungi. Plants provide the fungi with sugars in exchange for things that are just out of reach in the soil, such as phosphorus, but also nitrogen and even water. Plants, as we know them, don't survive on their own. They get by with a little help from their friends. So crops obtain about half the nutrients they need this way. But if we could increase that, we could greatly reduce our dependence on chemical fertilizer. And that would essentially be the next green revolution. So why hasn't it been done? Despite the fact that we've been studying plant-microbe interactions for decades, there are still big gaps in our knowledge. For instance, why don't all plants form these interactions? How do the plant and fungus communicate chemically? How does the plant know how to differentiate a beneficial fungus from a parasitic one? When you think about all of the players that are involved in these interactions, from the genes to the proteins to the chemical signals, it can feel like being lost in a thicket of information. What we need is a map. So my goal is to make a map of what is going on in these roots at the molecular level. And I do mean a map, a 2D representation of where the genes are expressed, overlaid on an image of the root like the one you see behind me here. It works like this. I take a slice of root that is colonized with the beneficial fungus, and I lay it on a specially coated slide that captures the mRNA. What I'm left with is a picture that I can zoom in on right down to the molecular level to see where each gene is expressed. That's called spatial transcriptomics. So when you combine my data-rich map with the data sets that other people are developing for plant roots, what we're going to end up with is a grand atlas. And we can use this to chart a course to engineer these interactions to be more efficient or make it so that more plants can interact with these microbes and not just the ones that have already evolved to. So theoretically, you could use this to save your dying house plant. But the real goal of modifying these interactions is food security. We want to be able to grow healthy crops with more sustainable fertilization. I hope we look back on this era of big data and say that we mined for discoveries that lead to the next green revolution, because that can't come a moment too soon.
Thank you, Margot. Who's ready for some trivia? Okay, in 1981, can anybody remember that far back? The first woman physics professor of UC Berkeley joined Berkeley Lab. Who was she? Was she A, Judith Kleiman, B, Ling-Ling Chow, C, Mary Kay Gaillard, or D, Persis Drell? Vote now. Vote often. And the answer is Mary Kay Gaillard. But of course you knew that, didn't you? Of course, too easy. We need to get harder ones. All right, up next is Lisa Klaus. Lisa's heart and home reside in Germany. And if she wasn't thoroughly invested in computer science, she would open up a bakery or cookie shop and I would be the first in line. I can almost taste that heavy crusted dark rye bread. So I can imagine from slam to British baking show, she will go. Representing the computing sciences area and presenting live from her apartment in Livermore, California, here's Lisa with fighting climate change with computer software.
We didn't start the fire, or did we? This summer, the Dixie Fire in Northern California burnt more than 900,000 acres. Climate change results in drying of plants and trees and has doubled the number of large fires in the past 30 years. Wouldn't it be wonderful if we could come up with a strategy to mitigate these effects? We can, with simulations and supercomputers. Simulating the real world helps us predict which actions lead to a better or worse climate, so we can adjust our behaviors to lower global temperatures and the number of devastating fires. Simulations are based on finding solutions for mathematical equations. The equations that represent climate behavior lead to hundreds of millions of data points. 40 years ago, we couldn't imagine handling these massive data sets accurately. Back then, we could represent global changes in Western Europe, but didn't have enough detail to show the Alps. Now, with modern supercomputers, we can distinguish between changes in the mountain ranges and river valleys. But why do we need supercomputers? A typical laptop would need years to handle these massive data sets. We don't have that time. The fires are burning now. Supercomputers are powerful, but only in combination with specialized software. My team creates software that effectively uses modern supercomputers to accurately solve these large problems. Supercomputers comprise thousands of smaller parts called nodes that are interconnected. Our software breaks up large data sets into smaller parts so that each node can process a part of the equation. But the data parts aren't all the same size. Some are very big, so we need to compress them. You might know compression from photographs. With a compression format such as a JPEG file, you will fit more files onto a memory card, but you will also sacrifice quality, which doesn't help your dating profile. In the same way, we need to find the right compression balance to accurately solve our equations. This is where I come in. I combine two methods, butterfly compression and block low rank compression. This novel combination advances our software efficiently. Butterfly is a very complex method, well suited for compressing climate data. It is great for bigger parts because it compresses a lot, which saves storage. However, its complexity makes it too time consuming to use for the smaller parts. Block low rank is a classic compression technique, well suited for the small parts. Combining both methods gives us the best of both worlds and allows us to harness the power of supercomputers to solve some of the biggest problems in science. And we are one step closer in predicting accurately which measures we can all take to prevent devastating fires.
Super. Thank you, Lisa. Okay. So now on to our next trivia round. This former Berkeley Lab ALD Associate Lab Director was the director of the Office of Energy Research, now the Office of Science, during the Clinton administration and served as the first female ALD in the National Lab system. Who was she? Was it A, Mildred Dresselhaus, B, Carrie Ann Jones, C, Hazel R. O'Leary, or D, Martha Krebs? So vote. And the results are coming in. And I think and we have the answer. The answer is, of course, Martha Krebs. Lots of people didn't think it was Mildred Dresselhaus, which is good job. Martha Krebs was the first first female ALD in the National Lab System. Okay, so next up is Maria Junkova. So Maria was born in Slovakia, but considers Spain to be her home. During the pandemic, she acquired a new hobby, tide pooling. I don't know what that is either, but we'll hear a little bit more about what she's discovered. Representing the Biosciences area and the Joint Genome Institute, presenting live from the Integrative Genomics Building at Berkeley Lab, here's Maria Junkova with Treasure from the Tide Pools.
What is the nudie wrong? Let's go down and see. below the surface of the ocean. Nudibranchs move in slow motion.
When walking by the ocean at low tide, I look for nudibranchs, these colorful slugs from the tide pools. Nudibranchs are known to harbor different chemicals, which can be toxic or disgusting to their predators. But if we find the right one and we find the right dose, these toxins could be used for killing plant pathogens or cancer cells. For our research, we would need a lot of toxins, but it would be so sad to kill so many nudibranchs, right? Well, with new technologies, that's not a problem anymore. Through DNA sequencing and genome engineering, it's possible to read the DNA sequence of the toxin genes and use it as a recipe for producing the toxins in our lab. But there is still a big question. How do we find the right toxin sequence? In the past, the researchers just took the nudibranchs, put them in the blender, and they automatically assumed that the toxins are produced directly by nudibranchs in their skin cells. But I'm a microbiologist. Knowing that the skin of all humans and animals is full of beneficial microbes, I ask a question. Are there any bacteria in the nudibranch skin helping to produce the toxin? When I started, nothing was known about the nudibranch. For my experiments, I needed to find the right one among the millions of unknown microbes. For that purpose, our group has developed a special fluorescent molecule, which is absorbed only by those bacteria which really produce the toxin. We then use a high-throughput cell sorter, which scans thousands of bacteria per second and collects only those ones that have really absorbed our special molecule. Like a treasure-seeking detector on a beach, we have discovered a brand new bacterial species. It forms less than 1% of the total nudibranch microbiome, and it would not be detectable otherwise. And what's more exciting, these bacterial species contain genes for production of a previously unknown toxin. Our research has revealed an amazing relationship between the nudibranchs and the few microbes in their skin, helping to protect them against predators. Imagine if we could later show that these bacteria contain toxins that can kill plant pathogens or cancer cells. That would be awesome. So now, always when I'm walking by the ocean, I am thinking about the bacteria in the nudibranch skin because they are the real treasure from the tide pools.
Seriously, Sinead, never heard of tide pooling before? You really ought to get out more. I hope you've learned something today. Who's up for trivia? Which of Ernest Orlando Lawrence's cyclotrons was the first to break the 1 million electron volt barrier? Your choices are the 11 inch, the 4.5 inch, the 60 inch, or the 37-inch cyclotron. Vote now, vote often. And the answer is, did we get it right? Help me out here. Was it the 11 inch? Yes, it was. Bravo. Let's move on. Ryan Kinsbury hails from Houston via North Carolina most recently. He's a trumpet player, and perhaps we can get an encore performance of the piece he composed for Wind Ensemble. Representing the energy technologies area and presenting to us live from high atop the hill in building 33 at Berkeley Lab, Here's Ryan with, if the stew fits.
How many of you could reach out and touch a battery right now? I'm guessing all of you, because batteries are everywhere these days, in your phone, your laptop, maybe even in your car. And those batteries rely on small charged particles called lithium ions to make power. So the more batteries we need, the more lithium we need. Right now, lithium is only produced in a few places in the world that are far away from here. So as lithium becomes more important to us, we need to produce it closer to home. And that's why the state of California has spent millions of dollars trying to filter lithium ions out of water in the Salton Sea. Filtering ions is hard though, because that lithium is all mixed up with other kinds of ions like sodium or magnesium or chloride. And our filters don't do a good job just picking out that lithium that we want. The challenge we face here makes me think of the Cinderella story when the prince has to search an entire village full of people to find the one person that he's looking for. Now we know he uses the glass slipper to do that, a material that is so well tailored to the unique characteristics of Cinderella's foot that it won't fit anybody else, making it the perfect filter. When it comes to filtering ions though, we don't consider all of their unique characteristics. Historically, we've designed our filters based only on their size and their charge. And this doesn't work very well because there are a lot of ions with about the same size and charge, so you can't tell them apart. It's like going to the village looking for Cinderella and saying, she's tall and has blue eyes. It's not precise enough. So my research is about developing glass slippers for ions. That is, filtration materials that are precise enough to let us pick out just the ion we want. Now to find that perfect fit, I need to try on hundreds or even thousands of candidate materials to see how they interact with those unique ion properties. To do that by trial and error in a laboratory could take years, maybe even decades. So instead, I use quantum chemistry simulations to show me those unique properties and predict how well a material is going to work before going into the lab, shortening the time to discovery. And this isn't just for lithium, by the way. I can apply this approach to any kind of ion filtration problem. So for example, if we could learn to filter industrially important metals like cobalt for batteries or neodymium for the magnet in your hard drive, we could transform industrial supply chains with new ways of recycling waste. And with better ion filters for pollutants like nitrate or phosphate, we could develop additional sources of clean water to help us adapt to a changing climate. So whether we're talking about clean energy, clean water, or high-tech manufacturing, making better ion filters is the key to new green technology.
Super, thank you, Ryan. So, new question, everyone. In an episode of the CBS show, The Big Bang Theory, I'm sure you've all seen it, Sheldon Cooper unsuccessfully pitched a collaboration request to this Berkeley Lab astrophysicist and Nobel laureate at a conference. Which Nobel laureate did Sheldon meet? Was it A, Saul Perlmutter, B, Francis Arnold, C, Stephen Chu, or D, George Smoot? So which Nobel laureate did Sheldon Cooper hassle? And we've got your answers here. Okay, so it was close between Saul and George Smoot, but the answer is George Smoot. Well done, everyone. Okay, so next up, we have Eileen. Eileen is originally from China, and after 4 years in Beijing for his undergraduate, he moved to New York City for his PhD. But he says that wherever he is at the moment, he considers that to be home. So Berkeley Lab is home right now. He has been practicing bel canto singing for many years, performing at lots of local community events as a tenor. And you might recognize him if you've been tuning into the Berkeley Lab virtual open mic sessions where he's also performed. So representing my home area, the energy sciences area, presenting today live from Berkeley Lab, here's E, with a love story in 1/1,000,000,000 of a second.
When someone says, "I'm telling you a love story," you may feel, "Oh, here we are, cliche." But what if that story happens in 1/1,000,000,000 of a second? That is where science comes into play. Who are the bachelor and bachelorette? Their electrons in negative and holes in positive, the Coulomb law makes them attractive. But when there are too many electrons, it's just like a speed date in a hall room with overcrowded people. The attraction between individuals gets screened and becomes weak. High density of electrons and holes form a hot, messy, unbalanced state called plasma. To find a true love before it's too late, the density of electron hole must decay. With few of them, you can almost hear the increase of their heart rate. They start to form electron hole pairs at a balanced state, with acetone as their new household name. From unbound singles to bound pairs, 1/1,000,000,000 of a second is how long this transition believed to take in solid state. You just heard I said believed. This transition I just talked about is actually a famous hypothesis in physics that still waits for verifications. As an experimental physicist here at Berkeley Lab, I directly visualize and study this transition by making experimental movies. But it happens so fast. How do I achieve my goal? That is where ultra-fast science can play the role. I use two ultra-short laser poles. One is called pump, and the other one is called probe. The pump first comes in to excite electrons and holes in a single-layer semiconductor. The excitation is fairly strong, that it forms the plasma that is ready to go on. The probe follows in a short time to tick off an electron into a detection line so that I can capture a picture of the electron experiencing the transition at one instant moment. I can further control the precision of the time with 1,000 times better than 1/1,000,000,000 of a second. By scanning the time step by step, I can make a movie of the transition frame by frame. My research result resolved a fundamental missing puzzle in the solid state physics of the photo-excited semiconductor. But for myself, the ultimate reward is to see, especially in the same journey with you, how compelling and romantic the nature of physics really looks like.
I don't know about you, but I can barely remember what happened a 1/1,000,000,000 of a second ago. But I do remember it's trivia time. So pay attention. This Federal Energy Standards Program was developed by Berkeley Lab scientists to help consumers choose energy efficient appliances. What's the name of this program? Is it OnStar? Is it B, Energy Star? Is it C, Sunshot, or is it D, Clean Energy Standards? Please vote now. You have an answer, and that answer is B, Energy Star. Bravo, Berkeley Lab scientists. Bravo, audience. Let's move on. Pen Pen was born in the cool, comfortable climes of Kingming, China. Way up high at 6,200 feet elevation, it's a tiny village of 6.6 million inhabitants, only the 21st largest city in China. He's a golden golfer, an alum of the University of Minnesota, where he competed successfully in table tennis and was two-time state champion, collegiate champion. During the pandemic, he says that his cooking skills have improved significantly. I look forward to the dinner invitation, Ben. So representing the energy technologies area, here's Ben with Needles in the Haystack.
Did you know that for the past 60 years, we've been shooting our rockets using hydrogen? Who would have thought that the smallest and simplest molecule can have so much power? In fact, in June 2021, the Department of Energy launched a hydrogen Earthshell program, aiming to create a connected hydrogen economy by 2050. To achieve this, first, we must make hydrogen storage work. The conventional high-pressure compression and low-temperature liquefaction can take up to 50% of hydrogen's embedded energy. With this said, scientists have developed different ways to help us store hydrogen more efficiently. We can use small but porous molecule like a sponge or a cheese to physically absorb a lot of hydrogen, or use a material that can chemically bind to many hydrogen molecules. Within each type, there are tens to thousands of materials. So in total, there could be millions of potential hydrogen storage materials, a lot of which only exist in theories right now. Here, my research aimed to screen and predict the most economical and energy efficient hydrogen storage material for different applications. Sounds like finding a needle in a haystack, right? But with the correct screening tool I'm developing, this could be achieved. From the fascinating structural data and place them in a defined scenario, we conduct automated system simulations to understand the unique change of material properties and hydrogen storage behavior from laboratory to being deployed in the target large scale application and connect that with economics. So far, for example, I've looked into using hydrogen to provide backup power when there's an outage. For example, the recent hurricanes, and identified less than 10 of the promising candidate materials. We're currently expanding this approach to find out the leading hydrogen storage material for more applications in the future, like powering a truck or sailboat. In a case where none of these materials will work, negative results are also valuable because they'll let experimentalists know whether or not there is a target that even makes hydrogen work. Will hydrogen be the holy grail for clean energy? Honestly, I don't know. It's like a rising sun that gives us a lot of hope, but we have no idea how many clouds it has to go through. But you, or anyone that cares about sustainability, can help me brainstorm brand new hydrogen storage applications I haven't even thought of, and help me challenge and push its limit.
Thank you, Ken. Thank you. Okay, next, another trivia question. In 2019, my colleagues actually at the Molecular Foundry developed a new type of recyclable material that can be easily broken down without the loss of performance or quality. And if you had a conversation with me in the last 2 years, I've probably told you about this. So what type of material was developed? Was it A, glass, B, fabric, C, plastic, or D, paper? So what type of material was developed at the foundry that was a recyclable material? Okay, And I think all of the voting is in. And yes, 83% of you got plastic, right? Isn't that really cool? A recyclable plastic material. Okay, next up, we have Rajiv Ramanujan Prabhakar. Rajiv considers India, Singapore, and Switzerland his homes, but not necessarily in that order. A revelation that inspired Rajiv during the pandemic was the power of bringing people together during a crisis. And we can all relate to that. So Rajiv himself actually personally cleaned the doorknobs and frequently used surfaces in his lab in Zurich and has volunteered to do it for everybody in the audience. Representing, again, my home area, the energy sciences area, and joining us live from Berkeley Lab, here's Rajiv with CO2, what is it good for?
Well, CO2 is actually good for something. CO2 is good for something? CO2 causes global warming and climate change. How can I say that it's good for something? Well, we can learn from plants that have been converting CO2 into fuels using sunlight for thousands of years. We can do it much more efficiently using materials called semiconductors, which can absorb sunlight and make electrons, and these electrons can convert CO2 into fuels. This process is called CO2 reduction. If it is so simple, why are we not doing it on a large scale? Do you see reactors in your city that convert CO2 into fuels using sunlight? Probably not. That's because with CO2 reduction, you make many unwanted products, not just the useful fuels like ethanol. My goal is to drive CO2 reduction to making only useful fuels. In my lab, I have advanced analytical tools that can help me solve this problem. Using these tools, I can investigate how the surface of the semiconductor, which absorbs the sunlight, reacts with the CO2 molecule in real time. There are two main parameters that I can use to control the CO2 reduction reaction. First is the intensity of the light. I can shine on the semiconductor the power of one sun, the same sun you experience on a hot day, or the power of 10 suns, and then look at what kind of fuels are made. Second, I can change the color of the light. I can shine all the way from the ultraviolet to the infrared, and then look at what kind of fuels are made. Now, by carefully tuning the intensity of the light and the color of the light, I can drive CO2 reduction to making only useful fuels. In doing so, hopefully, you will see reactors that convert CO2 to fuels using sunlight in your city very soon.
Sooner than later, I hope. This pocket-sized DNA tool was developed by Berkeley Lab to identify microbes in air, water, and soil samples. What is the name of this device? Is it A, phylochip, B, affymetrix, C, bead chip, or D, affyminer? Please vote now. And the answer is A, phylochip. There it is. Next up, we have Lydia Rachbauer. Lydia is originally from Austria. She is an artist at heart, practicing her hobby of capturing people's facial emotions through drawings. Representing the biosciences area in the Joint Bioenergy Institute, JBAI, here's Lydia with From Waste to Wanted, the Seaweed Story.
Remember the last time you were at the beach? Everything was perfect. The sun was shining, the sand felt warm underneath your feet, the cool ocean just waiting for you. And then you see it, the slimy seaweed barrier between you and the water. Ooh, and did you notice the smell? Wouldn't it be nice if we could turn this nasty goop nobody wants to see at the beaches into something essential and useful, something we want and need every single day? Actually, we can. When turned into liquid fuel, seaweed could substitute 10% of the nation's transportation energy demand. If you're more for the actual numbers, it equals to 620 million gallons of fuel. But we do need some help from tiny microbes, because in nature, this beautiful seaweed is made to persist. Seaweed is like a thick rope with multiple intertwined strings, making it extremely hard to decompose. It has a super complex structure with a lot of chemical bonds to resist degradation as much as possible. And that's why it takes at least 6 months for it to compost. And by that time, the beach season is so over. That's why I am looking for enzymes that break down these tough structures fast. And since our digestive tract is doing a pretty good job in decomposing our food, my search starts in a fish's gut. My challenge is to screen a ton of microbes to find expert degraders to produce enzymes with just the right kind of tools. Sometimes, imagine it as a Swiss Army knife found in a fish's gut. Because sometimes you need larger blades to break down the structure into smaller pieces so the enzymes can tackle the problem from all ends. And sometimes you need little scissors to fit the tiny gaps in a tightly bonded structure. Once I have identified the successful microbes, I take a closer look at their genetic blueprint to copy their enzymes and eventually reconstruct their Swiss Army knife to repeat the successful solution without the fish. I want you to remember that the highly specific enzymes found in a fish's gut do an exceptional job in breaking down these tough and resilient structures, and thus allow us to produce a multitude of useful products, including renewable fuel from seaweed. My research aims to fuel your beach vacation, and the next time you're at the beach, remember me and my fish guts and how they can help clean up the shores while filling your tank.
Thanks, Lydia. Great. Okay. Trivia time. This smartphone app was developed by Berkeley Lab to help consumers choose an energy efficient car model based on a user's unique driving style and patterns. What is the name of the app? And it's not Tinder. So A, True Car, B, Carfax, C, My Green Car, or D, Auto Trader. The answer is My Green Car. Okay, so 87% of you got it correct. Well done, 87% of you. Okay, so next up, we have Emmanuel Chan, So Emmanuel hails from Paris in France, bonsoir Paris. And besides being a technically professional astrophysicist, I guess his day job, he is an amateur astronomer and telescope maker, representing the physical sciences, joining us live from Berkeley, California. Here's Emmanuel with a cosmic shadow theater.
And our galaxy is only one of millions of billions in this amazing and expanding universe.
Ever seen the shadow of a galaxy? Just hold that galaxy between two fingers and place it in front of a light. It may seem impossible, but these shadows are actually one of the most powerful ways to learn about galaxies. Because when you look at a galaxy through a telescope, what you see is starlight. And that starlight does not tell you the whole story about the galaxy. It only shows you stars, and stars only make up a tiny fraction of the galaxy's content. In fact, this is one of the biggest problems in astrophysics today. Because of it, we don't really understand how galaxies work. What we need is a way to reveal all the hidden gas around galaxies. Wouldn't it be great if we could simply place a backlight behind a galaxy and reveal all the invisible gas through its shadow, just like a watermark on a dollar bill? Well, it turns out there already is a backlight out there in the universe, shining through all the galaxies. That light turned on a very long time ago with a bang, a very big bang. That light is the afterglow, the leftover heat from the Big Bang. It is everywhere, but it is very faint. So to observe it, my collaborators and I used one of the most powerful telescopes on Earth, located in the Chilean desert. We stared at a galaxy and searched for its shadow. But we couldn't find anything. The shadow was too faint to see. And that's when I remembered the little song you just heard a minute ago. That galaxy, remember, was only one of millions and billions in this amazing and expanding universe. So what I did is use the massive supercomputer at the Berkeley National Lab and accumulate the shadows from many, many, many galaxies, more than 100,000 of them. And slowly, as I added more and more galaxies, the shadow came into focus. The result is what you see here. This dark blob is the most precise galaxy shadow of its kind ever. An image like this one tells us a lot about how galaxies work. It shows that around every single tiny little galaxy in the universe, there is a gigantic gas cloud. And that gas cloud holds the key to galaxy formation. Now, this is only the beginning. New telescopes are now setting out to observe shadows from many more galaxies, tens of millions of them with unprecedented precision. And this will transform our understanding of galaxy formation. So next time you look at a beautiful image of a galaxy, remember, you haven't really seen a galaxy until you've looked at its shadow.
So some more trivia here. In 2008, Berkeley Lab scientists mimicked this structure of a sea creature's exoskeleton to create the toughest ceramic ever produced. Which type of sea creature was it? Is it A, a crustacean, B, a mollusk, C, an ectoderm, or D, Cnidaria? Vote please now. And the answer is the pronounceable B mollusk. Yes. All right then, moving on. We have Krishna Kumar Vasudevan, who is originally from Chennai in India, who spent 7 years in Athens of Georgia, that is, doing his PhD and then 5 years at Stanford as a postdoc. And I'm glad he found his way across the bay to Berkeley Lab. He's trained as a classical violinist, so we'll have to strike up the Berkeley Lab Chamber Ensemble, and maybe Ryan can contribute his trumpet. His pandemic silver lining is that he became a father to a beautiful daughter. Congratulations, Krishna. Representing the biosciences area and the Joint Genome Institute, presenting from the newest building at Berkeley Lab, the Integrative Genomics Building, IGB, here's Krishna with Designing Sensational Algae. Take it away, Krishna.
One singular sensation, every little step she takes. One thrilling combination, every move that she makes. One smile and
song. Can you guess what do plastic bottles, lipstick, and toothpaste all have in common? They're all derived from fossil fuels. You're all surprised, aren't you? This just goes to show how greatly we are dependent on fossil fuels for our everyday life. In order to create a more sustainable environment, which we really need for our survival, we need to find better alternatives for making these products. One alternative is to use the power of living cells. Living cells, you think, how can that be? It is possible because many cells contain genes that can produce these ingredients. My project is focused on harnessing the power of living cells to produce these renewable ingredients. So, how do I do this? I just simply turn these genes on, right? It can be, but many of these genes are not turned on normally. One way around this issue is to put these genes in closely related organisms where it is much easier to turn these genes on. For rapidly transferring genes across multiple organisms, a synthetic biology tool called CRAGE was developed here at Berkeley Lab. Eureka, I thought. I can use this CRAGE tool to put genes of interest into my ideal organism, an organism that can grow fast, can easily take in the genes, and it's cheap to produce. And the organism I chose is algae. Algae are like little green machines that run using the power of the sunlight and not by fossil fuels. Some well-known examples of algae that you all might know are seaweed from the beach and pond scum. I take these algae and use synthetic biology tools to make sensational algae. So what do I do with these cells? Remember those plastic bottles, lipstick, and toothpaste? Soon, you will be using these products that are not made from fossil fuels, but are made by harnessing the power of sun through the sensational algae.
Thanks, great job, Krishna Kumar. Okay, next up. This is a recent one, so you should all remember it. Who shared the 2020 Nobel Prize in Chemistry? Was it A, Akira Yoshino, B, Francis Arnold, C, Jennifer Doudna, or D, Ada Yona? And of course, you all got this one right. It was, of course, Jennifer Doudna. Okay, next up. Next up, we have Sten Valent, who is from Belgium. And he actually just got back in time for the slam because he's freshly back from a field expedition in Alaska. He's an avid runner, biker, and swimmer, so I'm already exhausted. Representing the Earth and Environmental Sciences area, here's Stan with Twin Telepathy.
Hi, I'm Stan. I'm an electrical engineer at Berkeley Lab, but today I will be talking about my digital twin. He's also at the lab, and he works with Earth and environmental scientists to make sure that people keep access to drinkable water as climate changes. And now you must be wondering, what is this digital twin? Well, he's a copy of myself, but he runs in a computer simulation on our supercomputer at the lab. And as you can see, he looks exactly like me. We even have the same behavior. And we also have this twin telepathy going on. So he feels always exactly like I feel. Now you must be thinking, how is this possible? Well, actually, as I said, I'm an electrical engineer, and I build these wireless sensors that measure my parameters and send them all the way to the supercomputer to the digital twin so he can copy my behavior. And that's pretty interesting because it means that when I get sick, he will be sick too at the same time. And then we can actually experiment with medication on him instead of on the real me. Now, I see that someone posted something in the chat. So they say, why did this nerd create a digital copy of himself in a simulation on a supercomputer? Aren't there enough nerds at the lab already? Ouch. So there's two answers here. First of all, there is no such thing as too many nerds at the lab. And second of all, actually, you're right. We don't need a copy of myself at the lab, whether it's digital or not. What we're actually working on is digital twins of ecosystems like this mountainous watershed here in the Rocky Mountains. And those sensors that I was actually talking about, they don't really measure my parameters. There's already enough 5G conspiracy theories around. They actually monitor weather conditions and snow melt and water quality. And so my challenge at the lab is not only to build and design those sensors, but also to connect hundreds of them in the field, because in the field, we don't have cellular connectivity. So my work focuses on novel wireless technologies like 5G and long range transmissions. And I'm even working on cell towers for the field that work on simple AA batteries. And so that means that if we can connect our sensors in real time from the field to the digital twin at the lab, then scientists can see in real time in spring, for example, that the snow starts melting and then the rivers swell, and they can simulate diverting some of the meltwater into reservoirs. And that actually means that these 5G connected digital twins, they can actually not only prevent floods, but they can also make sure that millions of Americans keep year-long access to drinkable water. That's great, high five.
Is nerd spelled with E or U? Ah, trivia. Speaking of Jennifer Doudna, she's also got an appointment with Berkeley Lab. And we know already that she won the 2020 Nobel Prize in Chemistry, but what was it for? What did she discover? Is it A, CAR T? Is it B, Cas-CLOVA? Is it C, talons, or D, CRISPR? Vote, please. And the answer is DeCrispa. Everybody knew that clearly, except for 6% who were just lying. All right, moving on. We have our closer. Yusuf Yoon was born in South Korea, but considers Boston and Berkeley his second hometowns. Yusuf considers himself a shy person, so presenting at the SLAM might come as a surprise to his colleagues. With the pandemic, he's happy not to be on the road so much and to be able to spend more time at home with his wife, a postdoc at Stanford. So representing the energy sciences area, presenting live from his apartment in Redwood City, California, here's Yusuf with lightsabers at the nanoscale.
Have you ever imagined having a real lightsaber? Ever since I watched the Star Wars lightsaber duel by Obi-Wan and Darth Maul, I fell in love with those amazing weapons and wondered how to make one. Well, a powerful laser beam can already cut through steel. Those laser beams propagate forever, but we can use mirrors at the two ends to trap light. But there's a key feature that is missing from conventional lasers, and this one is tricky. Lightsabers, they clash, they repel each other, but normally light beams don't do this. In fact, it is extremely difficult to make light beams repel. However, we can solve this problem. Let me show you how. I use a special cloudy gas called Rydberg atoms, which are highly excited atoms with a lot of energy. And I trap these atoms between two mirrors and fine-tune the laser wavelength. Then this light beam mixes with the Rydberg atoms and become hybrid particles that are half light and half matter. They still have properties of light, so they can propagate and shine, but they also have properties of atoms, so there is a strong repulsion between them. Now, I can effectively make a lightsaber in a lab, but the Lawrence Berkeley Lab's mission is not to battle our enemies. Instead, lightsabers can potentially replace those millions of transistors in computers. Transistors are basically switches where you can turn the electric current on or off. A computer processes everything in terms of ones and zeros, where the presence and absence of electric current represent ones and zeros. But the problem is that they are very inefficient. When electrons flow through wires, they tend to bump into each other and generate heat. And that's why our computers and smartphones get hot. On the other hand, if you have two lightsabers and turn on one of them first, then the second lightsaber cannot be turned on because they repel each other. If you turn this one off, then the second one can be turned on. This is a switching operation done by two lightsabers. These lightsaber switches are much faster and much cooler than conventional computer chips, because they are made of light. And I am working to improve the lightsaber efficiency so that they can work even at the very dim light level. To make them more efficient, we need smaller lightsabers. But Rydberg gases, they tend to spread out and take a large volume. So we need to find the special gas that lives inside a small solid-state material, and we are still hunting for the right one. And that's why I'm trying to make lightsabers at the nanometer scale for fast and efficient computing devices.
That was truly fantastic. Tip of the cap to all of you. You all made it. Audience, please stick around for some important information, but first, let's call all the finalists back up to the virtual stage for a massive round of applause. Let's show them some love through the chat.
Okay, so don't go away quite yet. I've got some very important information for you all. So now it's time for all of the audience and the judges alike to do your civic duty and vote, because we haven't had enough votes recently in California. So while the judges deliberate, you will all have a chance to vote for your favorites from today. So the judges are gonna deliberate and reconvene in about 15 minutes time. But in the meantime, we've actually prepared something for you all. So we have the musical stylings of Berkeley Lab's finest Groove Lounge with DJ Miles Green, And in addition to that, we're going to share some highlights of the previous year's SLAM. So keep your Zoom window open, enjoy the Groove Lounge. You'll see some highlights from the previous years, and don't forget to vote.
Thank you, DJ Miles Green, the voice of Berkeley Lab, for those chill tracks. But despite that musical therapy interlude, the tension here is thick. So thick, you could cut it with what, Sinead?
A lightsaber.
First, thanks to the audience for hanging in there and logging your votes. And to our esteemed panel of judges, we appreciate you for making what we know are some very hard decisions. So to you, Carol Burns, Aditi Chakravarti, Honorable Terry Taplin, Dr. Alan Wan, and Sarah Yang, thank you.
So one of the key people that put this all together is Meg Rodriguez in the Career Pathways office, and Justin as well. So they're going to join us shortly to take their bow, but that this has all really been down to the hard work of the Career Pathways office. Our AV and audio has been pretty smooth, I think you'll all agree, especially with the smooth tunes of DJ Miles Green that we all got treated to. So Miles and Darren were responsible for helping us out with getting everything working and all of our Zooming and Zooming here and Zooming there. We got it all working and all together. Our communications team at LBL, especially Suzanne Budd, Kelly Owen, and Mariah Parker, were really essential in getting us together and getting everyone knowing about the SLAM happening and ensuring that not only everyone at Berkeley Lab knew what was happening, but people from further afield. I saw some lots of guests in the audience today. We had creative services also help with our artwork and video production. Especially want to thank Susan Brand and Kat Jungquist for helping us out with all of the artwork and video production today. And an extra special thanks to Tor Swift, who put together the video that you all saw at the beginning, at the start. We also have a special thank you to Brian Mallow, who agreed to interview all of our 12 SLAM finalists. And we got the chance to put together a highlight video at the very beginning, but there are longer interviews available on slam.lbl.gov that I encourage you all to look out for. So David, did I miss anyone? I think I did, but.
A lot of people involved in this production, and I thank you, Sinead. It's nice connecting after all this time, even if only virtually.
The tension. Shall we tell them the big secret we've been hiding?
Oh no, are we ready? I think
we're not ready, but we do have another event that some of our participants from today will be taking part in.
Yeah, if you'd like, I can tell us a little bit about it.
Okay, you can tell the secret then.
Okay, then. So the top three winners from today's proceedings will join the inaugural Bay Area Research Slam, which is, mark your calendars, Thursday, October 28th at 3 p.m. Pacific. So in this Bay Area Slam, Berkeley Lab will compete against the finalists from Lawrence Livermore, Sandia National Lab, Bay Area, Slack National Lab for the Bay Area Bragging Rights. So make sure you put it on your calendar and hope to see you there, Sinead.
Oh, of course. Although we will get a rest that time, so we won't have to be the MC Square duo this next time around. We get to relax in our pajamas from the comfort of our living room, I think, this time.
Indeed, yeah. And the audience will get a break too.
Okay, so I believe that they're juking it out in the judging. Oh, do we have some air from the judges?
Okay, and then Mike, if you don't mind doing the honors, and there will be a drum roll.
I'm ready for a drum roll. The audience choice award is Ryan Kingsbury. Congratulations. Next, the third place award. Third place award goes to Rajiv Ramanujam. Rajiv, step up. And the second place winner is Ryan Kingsbury. Take it away, Ryan, again. And now, the biggest award of all. Getting a longer drum roll, first place is Lydia Rachbauer. Thanks to our judges for their tough decisions, and thank the audience for your selection.
And thank you, Mike. What happened to Lydia? I mean, She's not gonna take that $3,000. I think I know how to spend it. There she is, give it up for Lydia. Drum roll, clap, bravo, Biosciences, representing J-Bay, bravo. All right. Well, that was
took me a minute to take that in.
There we go. Fantastic. That was quite a show. Thank you, judges. Thank you, Mike. Thank you, Sinead, Meg, and company. And as I mentioned before, put it on your calendar, and it being the Bay Area Research Slam, where Lydia, Ryan, and Rajiv, I think, will all compete against those lesser labs, but you know, they're pretty good in their own right. So we'll prove it to them on the 28th, 3 p.m. Be there. Oh, join us, champions. Let's celebrate. Congratulations all, job well done. Same time next year.
Be well, everyone.
Thanks, Sinead, over and out.